Hello, comic book fans, here's Earl Grey. I've experimented a bit in the last year, 2018, with getting comic books, the real comic books, in floppies form, so to speak. I don't want to get too much on that route and discuss the pros and cons of getting the single issues versus getting them in trades, the comics. But I wanted to do, nevertheless, a top 10 of my favorite stuff that I've read in this fashion here. It's highly subjective, even more subjective than my other lists, because there will not be a Batman or Gideon Falls or Ice Cream Man in it, all the good stuff that came out last year. But I will trade weight on these books, or even hardcover weight on these books. And I've really read just a tiny fraction of all the good stuff here. But I've read The New World, and I was amazed by issue one. This was fantastic, even though the premise is maybe not the newest. Reality TV cop falling in love with a victim. But it was told in this very colorful, more than just interesting way. Lots of interesting ideas how to convey a comic story. Even though it's sinister, it's maybe the most colorful comic of the last year. Fantastic stuff, and it continued to be at least really great. Maybe, I don't know where it falls in the end, downhill, but it came to a conclusion that was not really a conclusion. More embarrassing and totally disappointing coitus interruptus sort of thing. Therefore, just my number 10 in this list here. The Seeds had not disappointed yet, because number 2 came out in September, and there is still no number 3, if I'm not mistaken. Written by Innocenti and drawn by David Aja. And this is interesting in many ways, a future story. Thinking about it, there will be a lot of science fiction comics in this list here, with these interlude panels with speaking animals that reminds me a bit, just in terms of atmosphere, of Mike Mignola. And this is really interesting, about a zone in which is no tech allowed, and a journalist trying to get in, and aliens involved. Yeah, a lot of interesting ingredients, but it still has to come together to a convincing story. That has not happened yet. So, just my number 9. A bit hit and miss always is 2000 AD, these magazines. A lot of really cool stuff in it. Some stories naturally are not my cup of tea, but it's an interesting mix nevertheless, and I really enjoy getting science fiction comics in this magazine format here, and a lot of stuff to discover, and the English storytelling is still quite a bit different than the American, and so this is interesting for me as well. Really enjoyed Mars Attacks 1 and 2, published by Dynamite. I love Kyle Starks, and I like the cartoony way Chris Schweitzer drew this stuff here. Actually, I'm not usually the biggest fan of this cartoony way of doing comics, but it's a totally really good fit for this title here. So Mars Attacks is splendid, a splendid comic. Just here, more than a third of it, I haven't counted the pages, I have to say, but are silly ads for dynamite products. I don't know why they do have to do it in this fashion. Maybe then the issues would be so thin that they couldn't charge us with more than $3.99 for 20 pages of story. I don't know. It's really, really expensive. And that's, just to say this shortly, one of the bigger issues that I have with getting comics in this fashion year. Yeah, look at that back page here. No ad. This is just a relief that helps me to get myself focused on the real deal, on the comic, and Image does this a lot better than Dynamite, even though they have some ads in the back here. Do they? Yeah, but a lot less here, just this double page. But I wanted to focus myself on the comics. So Stellar is a goofy, feels a bit like 2000 AD, a science fiction comic. Very fun road trip of this girl here, which is a living weapon. And there's a lot going on in these comics here. And this is really, a whole story with start, middle, and finish, and a lot of different stuff between. Universes were built and destroyed. Almost a bit too much happening, maybe, with this here. Well, fast-paced, but easy to get story, totally fun, comic book fun. Maybe a bit too dark. Why don't, the destroying worlds and end of the world stuff here isn't always so my cup of tea. Maybe you can have it a bit smaller. Tell us about the lives of just some characters in the future without having always the universe or the earth at stake. So yeah, a bit lower the stakes a bit, just in my opinion, and won't hurt me. This is too abstract if it's always the world or nothing. And talking about abstract comics, and we are now in at number 5 in my top 10. The Green Lantern, written by Grant Morrison and drawn by Lian Sharp. What's his prenum? Actually, Sharp. You know that guy. And he, maybe 2000 AD is one of the constants in my top 10 list here, because this story here feels totally like a comic that could have been published in 2000 AD, the magazine. And it's a new start of the Green Lantern. I don't know actually what to tell you what you don't know already about this. Even you love Grant Morrison like I do, or you hate him with a passion, and then my little video here won't help. But this is really a fantastic, dense comic. A lot of stuff is happening. My only concern is that Grant Morrison is maybe trying too hard when he starts a new series, and you can feel his passion, that's fantastic, but you can also feel the pressure that's on him to do something new, and that's maybe a bit against telling a lightweight comic book story. So, but I really enjoyed it. Now, a lightweight comic book story that was fun, even though it's against it's again in some kind of end of the world scenario. I don't want know what it is with these end of the world scenarios that every comic seems to indulge in this kind of stuff. Murder Falcon, about this guy here who serves as a kind of energy source for this Murder Falcon here. When he shreds the guitar, this guy here can fight monsters. And the guitar player gets his band together, so it's a sort of getting the old band together story combined with a kaiju story, and it's of course totally silly and goofy and weird. And if you don't want to read goofy and weird and silly comics, I can't help you. But this was really fantastic in my book. Really worth these books, the money here. And that was my number four. So we come to number three. And this is a bit of a difficult one, because all the Sandman universe books here. I really don't know why they don't get the love that in my book they deserve. At least the Sandman universe, this one shot here and The Dreaming, these are fantastic comics. And The Dreaming in particular, drawn by one Bilquis Everly, don't even know if this is a female or a man, is drawn fantastic, and it gives me the feels of the old Sandman stories here, even though these ads here all over. And DC, I won't eat another Snickers in my whole lifetime if you put another of these stupid Snickers ads in it. That's so stupid. If you read a fantastic comic and on the next page silly stuff like this appears. I know a lot of people like the ads in the comic books. I don't. I really don't. So where was I? Yeah, and it's a good idea that the central book, I guess this is the leading book of the Sandman universe books, a focus on the dreaming as a reign or the realm of the dreaming. What happens in this realm? And of course, it's not the cleverest idea, I think, to make the central premise, Lord of the Dreaming, Morpheus is absent, he's away, because actually we had this already. But what they do of this premise is really interesting, and I like the stuff here a lot. And to be honest, I don't really get yet what Lucifer is all about, but what the Fiomaras do here art-wise is really convincing, and me not really understanding what's going on is not in this frustrating way of I don't get it, but it's more a promising kind of not getting it, because I see glimpses and I think maybe I know where it's heading, and it's a real nice book. The easiest to get of all these books is definitely, I think, the Books of Magic. This is a straightforward Harry Potter-like comic book tale. Not as dense as the others, but therefore really easy to read. Good fun story. Maybe I would not read this if it's not part of this universe thing. I have a knack for voodoo, African religion, cults of this. Not that I really understand what's going on, but I have some sort of fascination for this. And therefore, House of Whispers is interesting for me, even if the artwork in it can't hold a candle to these fantastic covers. The covers were drawn by Sean Andrew Murray. The insides were done by one Dominique Stanton. So, covers were great. I would hope he would do the interiors for some comics, but I think this would take forever because it looks like hard work. The insides are sometimes a bit clunky and sometimes better, but always there are thrown some panels in or faces that really are a bit strange. Yeah, maybe not everyone's cup of tea, but for me it's really interesting. So, but the whole stuff here deserves part 3 in my top 10 for the most part because of The Dreaming and Lucifer. These two are really good comics. So now we come to number 2, Proxima Centauri by Farrell Dalrymple. Very goofy, sketchy ride into the Farrellverse again, and I can't get enough of the stuff of that guy. What can I tell you? It's loose cartooning at its best. Sometimes the art takes over the story, and sometimes the story comes back to the surface of these comic books, and always fleshing out this mysterious Farrellverse. You get more glimpses into the head of Mr. Dalrymple, and unique, very obscure individual take on science fiction, fantasy, and just a joy in every fashion, even though it's really hard to say what's going on. But that's the strength of Farrell Dalrymple. You really can enjoy his comics, and even without knowing what is this guy talking about in his pictures. So, I think no surprise for you, Love and Rockets. 5 and 6 came out the last year, 2018, and these books here were actually the reason for me to start the whole floppy experiment in a way, because over here you can't order Love and Rockets via Amazon or eBay or whatever. You have to subscribe to the stuff here, and when I subscribed to Love and Rockets, I figured why not get some of the other books to make my package a bit worthwhile. And still I have a bit of my problems with Gilbert stuff, and I would like him to come back to more relatable, believable characters. He's still fooling around with us readers a bit, with this all huge cast of different characters, all have this big-breasted Luba features. It's still fun, of course, but what makes these comics, these two issues here in particular, enjoyable are again the contributions of Yame. So, but that could not be a surprise for you that this would be made my number one, I think. So, this was my least objective list of top 10 list of comics of 2018. Let's see what else I have in store. Thanks for listening and watching. Goodbye.